Good morning, and may it please the court. Sonam Henderson for the appellant, Stephen Duarte. I plan to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. I'll watch my clock. There are approximately 20 million Americans with prior felony convictions, many of whom have committed no violent acts. This is a case about whether the government can, consistent with Bruin, permanently strip gun rights from those many prior felons with only nonviolent convictions without showing that the founders permanently deprived nonviolent prior offenders of the right to bear arms or otherwise imposed a similar burden on gun rights for a similar reason. In my time today, I want to address three things. First, I want to talk about how broad the power the government is claiming to disarm anyone it deems untrustworthy, non-law-abiding, or irresponsible is, and how that would eviscerate the Second Amendment right and return us to a regime of deference to legislative
decision making. Counsel, before you do that, I'm really interested in your position in light of the concurrence that Justice Kavanaugh and the Chief Justice handed down in Bruin. As you know, I think, they referred back to Heller, and they said, let me make sure I get the right quote here, nothing in our opinion should be taken to cast doubt on longstanding prohibitions on the possession of firearms by felons. Right?
Yes, Your Honor.
So they're kidding, right? They just meant non-violent felons.
It's not that they're kidding, Your Honor. It's that's a concurrence. It's not the majority opinion. The majority...
But they joined in the majority. Without them, there would be no majority.
I understand, but someone concurring doesn't have the right to...
How about Justice Alito, who said the same thing, basically?
I'm not sure he said the same thing, but as it is, the main opinion of Bruin holds that there's one constitutional test for Second Amendment questions, and that is plain text and history. So the main opinion says...
But with respect, at least from my perspective, this is a two-part analysis. The first part is who's covered.
Right.
The second part is in what way and what firearms, et cetera. The first part is who's covered. And as I look at our earlier case, Zhang Say, and I know you take an exception, I want to get your view on that. Felons are excluded. They're just excluded. And that's Justice Kavanaugh, the Chief Justice, Justice Alito, Justice Amy Coney Barrett. They were necessary to the majority, and all of them, they don't use nonviolent felon. They say felon. Because anciently, historically, that's the way it was. So how do we get around that?
Again, by looking at the main opinion. I mean, the people opining about how a text and historical analysis might come out is different from actually performing the text and historical analysis.
But with respect, because we don't have a lot of time, that's why I'm asking these questions now. There were 14 mentions in Bruin about the 14th Amendment only applying to law-abiding citizens. What does that mean?
It's 14 mentions of law-abiding and responsible, or some combination of law-abiding and responsible. It's not saying it only applies there. In that language comes from Heller, and in Heller it's used to talk about what an easy case that is, right? They say, they go and they define people, and you're talking about who's in the text and who's out. They define people first, and they define that very broadly. Mm-hmm. All Americans, all members of the national community. Mr. Duarte, despite being a felon, is still an American.
Okay,
he's
a member of the national community. Well, that if you have 10 convicted murderers, all of whom are American citizens, that they're entitled in jail to a Second Amendment right?
In jail?
Yeah.
I think you'd get around...
Careful.
Sorry? I think you'd get around in jail by custody and by historical practice. I'm sure at the time of the founding, people who were in jail were not allowed to have weapons.
And felons go to jail sometimes, don't they?
Right, so when they're in jail. We're talking about people who are...
You're saying that only when they're in jail?
I'm saying I am sure there is a historical antecedent for taking weapons from people while they're in jail. I don't see a historical antecedent for keeping weapons from them once they've been restored to their freedom.
Well, on the Zhongzhe case, the argument that you make is one that was made in a case called United States versus Phillips. And Phillips concluded that R. Miller versus Gammy did not apply because they did not use the two-step analysis. They knew about Heller and applied it to individuals. Why does Phillips not say that Jiangxi applies in and controls this case?
Because of Bruin, Your Honor. Bruin clarified the Second Amendment analysis. Bruin comes in and it says, basically, all of the lower courts are misreading Heller.
Now, Bruin, in the first sentence, says, as set forth in the pleadings below, petitioners Koch and Nash are law-abiding adult citizens of Rensselaer County. How do you define law-abiding?
I don't, Your Honor. I don't think that's the constitutional limit. I think the court is describing these people as being law-abiding and responsible because they're saying this is an easy case. The way they use this in Heller is to say, we don't have to get into levels of scrutiny. We don't have to get into all of this because this is such an easy case.
Condition of law-abiding, don't we?
Sorry?
But it's a qualification. All adult citizens are law-abiding adult citizens.
All law-abiding, but again, the main opinion of Bruin is that you need to look at text and you need to look at plain text, you need to look at history. And there is no plain text analysis that limits the Second Amendment to law-abiding rights. If you look at the text.
Okay, counsel, with respect, I don't think you've read Heller either, because they both talk about law-abiding citizens.
Yes, Your Honor, they do talk about law-abiding citizens in Heller, but it's, as I was trying to say, it's they define people, and they define people broadly. And then when they get...
They refer to all Americans twice in Bruin, but 14 times law-abiding. So, again, here seems to be a contradiction here.
I don't see a contradiction, Your Honor. Again, when they explicitly, Heller explicitly defines the people, and it doesn't define the people as only law-abiding, responsible citizens. It defines the people as all Americans. When it goes on to talk about law-abiding and responsible citizens, it's when it's answering the dissent. The dissent says, how can you do this? How can you do this without telling us about levels of scrutiny? And how come you're not giving us a more fulsome explanation of how the Second Amendment works?
It did not do level of scrutiny.
Sorry?
Jiangxi did not use a level of scrutiny.
No.
Two-step process. Referred to Heller.
Mm-hmm.
Said that nonviolent felons were not covered by the Second Amendment. That's our binding precedent. Phillips says it is. Unless Miller versus Gammy allows you to overrule it, it controls this case, does it not?
Yes, but I believe under Bruin it's overruled because Bruin's...
The Miller versus Gammy analysis.
That is
so
Miller.
Tell me what in Bruin says that our case is overruled. It's just inconceivable that it can continue to have any viability in light of Bruin.
Miller v. Gammy says that precedent whose mode of analysis is clearly irreconcilable with intervening Supreme Court case law is overruled.
And how, Bruin and says, in what way is it irreconcilable?
So Bruin says there's one single analysis for the Second Amendment, plain text and history. It doesn't say there are two analyses. One is, does it show up on our list of presumptively lawful, or show up on the list of presumptively lawful regulations from Heller? And if it doesn't, then we do text and history. It says text and history. And even in Heller, the court's saying, these are, you know, we're not explaining why we think these things are presumptively lawful now. We'll do that when the case comes before it. And that...
But you're skipping to the second prong, in my opinion.
Okay.
You've got to define who's covered. I don't see how you get from Bruin, mm-hmm. where you have four justices that were essential to the majority, all saying the felons are covered. They're all covered. And they're not law-abiding citizens. 14 times they refer to that. And so if, just arguendo for a moment, okay? If that's correct, then there's no problem, right? Your client's just not covered.
If it's correct, I'm sorry, I missed which part, if which part is correct.
Well, that law-abiding citizens are the only ones covered by the Second Amendment. They assume that. And earlier in Heller, they talk about felons. So how do we get around that?
Again, because Bruin is saying you have to do text and you have to do history, and nobody has done that. You're talking about who's covered, first step, mm-hmm. plain text. Nobody has done a plain text analysis that says felons are not covered.
And the Supreme Court did, in the sense that they said it covered He's covering law-abiding citizens.
But
the boss, they decide.
They use the phrasing law-abiding citizens, but when it comes to the who of the Second Amendment, the operative clause of the Second Amendment, you know, the rights of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. The who is the people. And they plainly define the people, explicitly define the people.
But they accept out felons.
Yeah, but they say they presume, but that's a prediction about it, a textual or historical analysis that they haven't done yet, Your Honor.
Let me ask you this, and then I'm talking a lot here, but it's an important case.
Yep.
If the Bruin case and the Heller case do not overrule Shaanxi, it controls and you lose, right?
If Vongsay is not overruled, then yes, it controls. I agree with that. I want to hold on to some of my time, but I do just want to speak briefly about how broad a power the government is claiming. It does go to this law-abiding and responsible limit. I mean, if that's the limit, there's nothing in law-abiding that would limit us to felons as opposed to misdemeanants, as opposed to scofflaws who litter, speed. There's nothing in irresponsible that limits us to lawbreakers at all. I mean, taking on huge amounts of debt, that could be considered irresponsible. Being habitually late is irresponsible. And so if that's the constitutional limit, that leaves a lot of room for a motivated legislature, let's say the California Assembly, to start taking gun rights from people if they decide that that's what the most important thing is. And even the felon thing leaves the motivated legislature with a lot to work with. As it came up in Range, this idea that the government was asked, if the legislature made lawn mowing a felony, if the legislature makes jaywalking a felony, can we take those people's guns away? And the government says, because their rule is felons, yes. And so that's very problematic. It leaves a lot of room to impose on the Second Amendment and leaves us back with the legislature being the one who's deciding who has a Second Amendment right. And I'll reserve the rest.
Very well. Morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Your Honor. Saria Bahadu on behalf of the United States. And may it please the court. The question before this court is whether Vongsay remains good law, and it does. Bruin instructed courts to look at Heller, to apply Heller, and to apply the history and tradition test in Heller. That is what Vongsay does. Bruin also instructed courts to not apply means and scrutiny. Vongsay followed that instruction too. In our view, the simplest path in this case is to hold that Bruin is not clearly irreconcilable with Vongsay, and that Vongsay continues to apply categorically to felons, nonviolent or otherwise.
We were told in Heller that nothing in our opinion, that's in the court's opinion, should be taken to cast doubt on long-standing prohibitions of possession of firearms by felons. What are your long-standing prohibitions of firearms by felons in the historical tradition that you put forward to limit the text of the Second Amendment as applied to this individual?
The text of the Second Amendment?
Yes.
As applied?
To keep and bear arms.
Yes, Your Honor.
If, as I understand Bruin, once the conduct fits within the Second Amendment to keep and bear arms, mm-hmm. then the burden becomes the government's to show that there's a historical tradition of long-standing prohibitions on possession of firearms.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Where are your long-standing prohibition on bearing firearms by felons?
The long-standing prohibitions date back to England, Your Honor. In our brief, we talk about...
In the Statute of Northampton?
No, not the Statute of Northampton, right, which is going armed to terrorize a community. And I think there's actually the Statute of Northampton from 1328. But In our brief, we really talk about two categories of laws that we think aptly support 922 G1. The first category of laws are laws imposing capital punishment on felons and forfeiture on felons. And the laws imposing capital punishment date back to England, right? Blackstone, which courts, especially members of this court, have cited in a concurrence in Chauvin, as well as a dissental in Mai, have relied on Blackstone and its commentaries that in England, the penalty for a felony was death. And so
Let me ask you about that a little bit.
Yes, Your Honor.
At the very end, I think he talked about range. And in range, I think, if I'm right, they asked government's counsel, well, why couldn't California, they probably didn't use California, they used their version of California. why can't California just say jaywalking is a felony punished by a year and a day, of which will make a year and a day go away somehow. And then take away everybody's gun rights. So why couldn't you do that?
Let
me ask you this. Do you think if they made jaywalking a felony, could you say that that person couldn't have?
Well, in our view, we think history and tradition support disarming felons because they have committed serious crimes.
That's not an answer to my
question. I'm going
to
get there.
Yes. It's really important. People ask me all the time, now that you're a judge, what do you care? And so whether advocates, let's answer your question. You're not answering my question because it's a hard question. So So the question is, think of the hardest. The person, your best friend, who's an angel, and that whatever that person does, tears a tag off a mattress, suddenly that's a felony. Can that person, can they ban that person? And I think in range, the government's, and so I assume that you want to be consistent. So your answer yes or no?
In our view, if a legislature has labeled a crime a felony, then we do think that there's a history and tradition for disarming.
But that's good, because now we understand. So then that really brings to light the question of, even assuming there was, I think it's actually a hard question, whether there's a longstanding tradition for felons across, because you don't actually have any longstanding bans on felons. You have bans on other things. You have putting felons to death. But you don't have actually gun bans on felons. But let's just pretend there was. Let's say there was you had tons of evidence of actual legislatures at the time of the founding banning felons. But there was no examples of tearing a tag off a mattress as being a felony. Do you see the problem there? The problem is if you can, now the legislature can just basically say anything they want as a felony and they can bypass a constitutional right, just like you could say, there's been a longstanding understanding that fighting words were not. And so now we're going to say that any political speech by pick your party is a fighting word. And now all of a sudden the First Amendment goes away. So what is your answer to that problem?
The limiting principle is the question. And there are limitations on legislatures, and I can name a few.
Tearing a mattress sounds like it's pretty far down the slippery slope, trying to take off a mattress.
Well, I can name at least a few limiting principles that I think would apply to legislatures, that this parade of horribles simply would not occur. The first is that there are constitutional limitations, right? Legislatures cannot overcriminalize because other constitutional provisions would have something to say about it. That's the Due Process Clause, that's the Equal Protection Clause, that's also the Eighth Amendment.
What you're saying is, I think there may be a constitutional limit to the fact that they wouldn't be able to make tearing a tag off a mattress punishable by a year or something else, like cruel and unusual or something, right? But Second Amendment wouldn't speak to that, but it's possible that they couldn't make a tearing a tag off a mattress a felony constitution. Is that your argument? Just make sure I understand.
Well, I do think that the Second Amendment would have inherent limitations as well, because we know, for example, that the Second Amendment the point of the Second Amendment is not to disarm broad swaths of the American people. But I did want to speak to inherent limitations apart from the Second Amendment, because I understood the Honor's question to say, putting aside if we don't have exact historical analogs, what is going to keep a legislature in check? And so we do think the Second Amendment does keep the legislature in check now, thanks to Bruin, which has returned us back to Heller, because it's...
But to be clear, I think what you're saying is it keeps the legislature in check in the sense of anybody they want to disarm, they have to now label a felon.
No, I don't think that's correct. I don't think that's correct. I don't think that, for example, 922G has been a part of this country's history since at least 1938. That was its original form, and now we are in the amended form, I think, was in the 1960s. So for this amount of time, we've had legislatures operating under whether or not they could label something a felony, and they would have knowledge that that would then trigger 922G1.
But what they have labeled as a felony since the 1930s is very different than what they labeled a felony at the founding. And so are you saying that they could change from the founding to the 30s? You know, now we can have felonies for, like, literally filling. I mean, I think they had some fun ones, yes, in the brief, some real ones other than tearing up. But things that seem like they certainly wouldn't have been felonies at the founding. But you're saying we're stuck with what we had in the 30s? I don't think you're saying that.
No. I want to acknowledge that there's a bigger number of felonies than there were in 1791. And we look to 1791 for the principles that would essentially restrain legislatures. I do think that there are principles in the Second Amendment.
You don't have much time, so you're speaking kind of vaguely that I think there's some restraints, but you gotta realize, like, I'm actually trying to say as a practical matter, it doesn't sound like there's very much, because going back to what you first conceded, which is, listen, if you want to make tearing a tag off a mattress, if legislature wants to make tearing a tag off a mattress, then we think that that would make that a felony, then the Second Amendment doesn't prohibit it. But you're speaking about limitations, like, you know, in some vague abstract terms, but that doesn't sound like much of a limitation.
Well, I can give a few more. So I mentioned the constitutional limitations. I also think that there's the political process. Legislatures are proxy for their people, and we have seen time and time again.
So I understand that argument. Of course, you could say the same argument about the First Amendment. You could say First Amendment protects, and when the legislature says that you shouldn't be able to, you know, do X or Y, say X or Y, it's been through the political process. Okay, so I get both your arguments. I'm not hearing much. That sounds like the type of any other right that we would think, like the Fourth Amendment or the First Amendment, those arguments would never fly for those. So,
those amendments, though, have their own restrictions with respect to felons in particular, too. I mean, under the Fourth Amendment, right, we have felons who are subject to probation. They have lesser rights than the broader swaths of the community. We have felons who are subject to PCRS, which is a very strict form of supervision. I think even under the First Amendment, we do have some felons who are actually subject to lifetime supervised release, and they will have their First Amendment rights curtailed.
Can I get back for a second? I know my colleague is a real expert in this and wants to deal with these historical things, but I just want to make sure I understand the government's perspective on one thing. I gather that you contend that Jiangse controls in this case, that Phillips backs that up, and the only way it gets overruled is if we have an en banc court that changes it. Is that correct?
Yes, correct in part. Vongshe remains controlling precedent. But I would say that Bruin does not render Vongshe. Bruin is not clearly irreconcilable. So I even think...
That's my point.
Right.
In other words,
it's
the government's position that Jiangse is not clearly irreconcilable with either Heller or Bruin. And if that's the case, the only way Jiangse can be overturned, because it covers nonviolent felons, is to have an en banc court. We can't do it as a three-judge panel. Is that your position?
That's our position. And I just want to say that if this case did go en banc, we would again be relying on Bruin to say that this court's precedent has been in line with Bruin as well as Heller.
Two-part argument is Bruin hasn't abrogated our precedent, and even if it somehow had, you win anyway.
Right, because I do think that...
Can I take you back to Judge Smith's...
Cause absolutely.
The challenge with that position is... Voxgay relied on, what was the case that Voxgay relied on?
It relied on Younger. It relied on Everest, Emerest.
Wrote the decision.
It relied on a couple of cases, actually.
So Younger was pre, so Voxgay clearly relied on Younger and literally said that Heller has not abrogated Younger. And so the thing we're saying is binding has gone through two iterations of pretty serious Supreme Court changes. One is Heller, which said not a collective right, but it's an individual right, whereas Younger said it was a collective right. And then there was Bruin, which said, yeah, two steps, it's not a two-step thing. You got to look at history and tradition, period. So those are pretty significant changes. Everybody, I think, recognizes that. And yet you're saying that a decision, really it's not Voxgay, it's Younger, because Voxgay relies very heavily on Younger, that Younger... that predates both those very serious, so that still just binds clear through. That just sounds like, well, what does the Supreme Court have to do? Does it have to, like, literally name Vox Gay or Younger by name in its decision to abrogate them?
Okay, can I join in this question? Sure. Because I think we both have the same issue. The Phillips case analyzed the very thing that he's talking about, mm-hmm. where Heller had been decided, the argument was made by learned counsel for the defense that Heller overruled it because of reliance on Younger. They said, no, that's not true. If you're going to change it, you've got to have an en banc. So at least for our court's purposes, the Younger aspect is not going to change anything. The question is whether Bruin perhaps changed it. What's the government's position on that?
So I think I have 2 points that I do want to make. So in Vong Xie, it did point to Younger, but it explained that when it was saying that it was bound by Younger, it cited In re Osborne, which explained that this court is bound by holdings, not reasoning. And then the second thing that I did want to say as well is that Vong Xie did not just rely on Younger.
What does that mean? I read that.
I think
the problem with that is, does that mean that the Supreme Court, like, has to have precisely a nonviolent felon case? Otherwise, we're just bound. It doesn't matter how much its decision. Let's say it completely undermines. I know that's, you're not conceding this, but completely undermines the reasoning. But it's not a nonviolent felon case. It has to be a nonviolent felon case?
I mean, it has to be clearly irreconcilable, and I think this court has gone so far as to say it has to compel a different conclusion.
Well, let's say the rationale is completely irreconcilable, but the holding is not, because it's not a nonviolent felon case. So that's what I'm trying to get at. It's like, if the rationale, let's assume for sake of argument, the rationale is completely irreconcilable. In the first case, it was a judge that said, you know, I had an epiphany last night. God told me that you lose. And the Supreme Court says, you can't do that. You can't, judges can't have epiphanies from God and rule that way. But it's a different type of case. But does the epiphany holding from the Supreme Court abrogate our precedent? Or can you say, well, it's the whole, you know, there's epiphany rationale, or do you say, well, no, it was a different type of case, so Supreme Court's got to address that kind of case, or we're going to keep having epiphanies?
I think that would be incredibly hard to defend, I would say, but I actually would look to Vong Xie, because Vong Xie pointed to Younger, and it said...
We literally have 2 stages of the Supreme Court completely making a sea change in Second Amendment law, and you were arguing that precedent that goes clear back to that, and I understand... And I hope Judge Smith will let me finish my question. I understand that his position is, or at least you could make the argument that Phillips takes care of all the Heller stuff. So the first of the 2 stages is, but you still have 2 stages here of very different changes. And to say that doesn't change anything, can you see how, like, people would be like, well, what does the Supreme Court have to do? Like, I guess they have to name cases or judges by name.
No, I think, and I can see your point, I do, but I actually think Vong Xie recognized that point by not only relying on Younger. It didn't say, oh, Younger, the holding, we're done. It then looked at other gun regulation, other gun restrictions. It looked at other cases from around the country, including Fifth Circuit decisions that did look at the Second Amendment.
The decision, that actually specifically was the old two-step. The Fifth Circuit decision had applied the two-step balancing test that Bruin got rid of, so that's a problem, isn't it?
Well, no. The Vong Xie relied on Everest and Emerson, but if you look at those decisions closely, one of them, I believe it was Emerson, they both have E's, but Emerson, it does talk about tailoring, but it is very clear when it says that felon dispossession is clearly consistent with the Second Amendment as historically understood. So both of those decisions do speak about history in the way that Heller and the way that Bruin call for. And Vong Xie, I make the point mainly to say that Vong Xie didn't simply say Younger, we're done. Vong Xie looked at Heller, which of course had its own historical analysis and consideration. It looked at other gun restrictions, other cases from around the country, and it also looked at what modern scholars were thinking at the time. I see that my time is up, but unless the court has any further questions.
Questions, Judge Bannon? All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. We ask that the
court. All right, counsel, Mr. Henderson, you have a little time left.
Thank you, Your Honor. So I want to just start by pushing back on this idea that Vong Xie did historical analysis of the way that Bruin required. Vong Xie has a brief mention of historical analysis. It doesn't ignore it entirely.
Does it need to?
I mean, It depends on whether you think it has a plain text analysis that excludes it.
Again, as I look at it, there's a two-part analysis. Number one, who's covered? And secondly, in what way? And you've got at least four members of the Supreme Court in the majority that say felons aren't covered. And law-abiding Americans are covered. What's your answer to that?
Again, Bruin lays out how you tell who's covered. You tell who's covered by looking at the plain text. Nobody's looked at the plain text and explained why the plain text excludes anyone who's not law-abiding and responsible. That analysis didn't occur in Heller.
You think law-abiding American is a plain text analysis? You have to go through the historical analysis to make that determination, right?
Sorry, if you're saying that it's step one and that they are not non-law-abiding, non-responsible people are not covered. What Bruin tells us is that has to be done via the plain text. Does the plain text cover the conduct? I think the answer is very clear in Heller because the who of the plain text is the people.
Well, why then did Justice Kavanaugh, joined by the chief, say that nothing that they're saying in Bruin is intended to overturn the concept from Heller that felons aren't covered?
I mean, that may express some level of discomfort with where the logic of the majority opinion's going. I understand, but
either one of them, you don't have a majority.
But what the majority actually says is text and history, and whatever discomfort some members of the majority may feel about that, and however they may express that, as long as they've signed on to the majority opinion, the majority says.
You think Kavanaugh was saying he thinks mattress label tearing felons are covered when he said that?
I
guess another way of saying it is, you think he has an idea of? I mean, I guess what I'm struggling with is, like, I don't, if he, when he says, I don't think this puts means that the felon exception's gone. Obviously, built into that is some concept of some what felon includes, and I don't know, it's hard to read that one sentence as being, oh, that must be like anybody in the legislature, the government's position, which is anybody in the legislature says is a felon.
Swearing on the radio, whatever, right? I don't imagine that's what he means. I don't know what he means. I don't know how the Heller majority was planning to get to.
What I'm getting at is if a person was to say, if a person was to conclude that nonviolent felons were included under history and tradition, that's not necessarily inconsistent with the idea with the concurring judges saying that felons are included because some felons could still be included.
You're right, Your Honor. Yeah, because that would
the argument today that no felons are included. You're not fighting with Kavanaugh and the chief and others.
Not completely. I suppose I'm not fighting with, you know, if we're getting to what the outer range of felon is, if you're looking at some core set of felonies, maybe
your argument, I think, as I understand it, is simply that it doesn't necessarily need to be at the most broadest level of what the fact that they said that doesn't necessarily need to be at the broadest level. Is that
that
accurate?
And if they said that, they didn't get to it. They didn't finish it. Now we just deal with felons, right?
Right now we are dealing with what to do with felons. There's some notion of felons, but as Judge Van Dyke has pointed out, what is a felon?
They always tell us that we're not supposed to anticipate what they're going to do. So where are we on that then?
I would say you are reading the majority opinion for what it says, which is text and history, and doing that text and history analysis, which I believe takes us to nonviolent felons.
Your position is that long-standing prohibitions on possession have to go back to the colonial times.
That what Bruin and Heller say is that it has to be the understanding.
Standing would, if it was done in 1900, that wouldn't be long-standing.
That is not long-standing for the purposes of the Second Amendment.
Okay. Other questions about my colleague? No. We can talk about this forever, as you know. But in any event, thanks both counsel for your arguments.
Thank
have been
you
very
so.
Helpful. Very well. The case of United States versus Duarte is submitted.